Scarlett. Listen to these words from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Because no one can lay any other foundation than what is already laid, that is in Jesus Christ. And that's the foundation that we sing about this morning as we sing the solid rock. Let us stand as we sing together.
We welcome you this day where we have gathered as a body of faith to celebrate the freedom that only can be attained through the person and the relationship of Jesus Christ. If you're a guest or a visitor with us today, we want to welcome you to First Baptist, and we would ask you that you would do a little bit of a favor here and just let us know how you came to be at First Baptist. The worship guide, the messenger that you received when you walked on our campus on the very far right-hand side, there's just a little tear-off there. If you would fill that out for us and return it in one of two ways. Either A, you can place it in the offering plate in just a few moments, just as your gift to us, or you can hold on to it and do like many others have done today. Come to the guest reception immediately following the service. We'll have the opportunity to meet face-to-face, and I will take that card and exchange it for a free book. That being said, why don't we go shake a hand, hug a neck, welcome somebody to First Baptist Opelika today. It is so good to hear the fellowship, but if you would, make your way back to your seats. Thank you so much for welcoming those that are guests and visitors to our campus today. Let us pray. Lord, as we continue our time and our celebration of you together, Lord, we recognize that we live in a world that is in constant flux and constant change, and we are just barraged with so much information and so much stuff that is out there. How good it is to know that because of a relationship with you, that we do not have to be shaken. We can be secure and have that firm foundation. Help us today, oh God, to celebrate that goodness. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
God will never change. Our God will not be moved. We're so thankful for those truths of Scripture. Let us stand as we continue singing together. Listen to these words from Psalm 147 as we stand. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. How great is our God. Let's sing together.
Yeah. praying with me. Lord, thank you for today and for the fact that you're here. Lord, the regardless of circumstances and where we come from, that you are here and that you're in our circumstances with us. Lord, the greatness that you are, it is mind-boggling. And we just ask that you would help us remember who is great in our relationship, that it is only you, that it is not us, and that we need to be remembered, that we need to remember that and be mindful of the way that you love us and that you care for us. And Lord, because of that greatness, help us to see that we need to be your hands and your feet and serve you here, beginning with the way that we open our pocketbook this morning. Thank you for Jesus. In your name we pray.
Traveling a well-worn road, a sinner so far from home, no second chance in sight. I heard you call my name. I felt you lift my shame, and I made a vow that day that I'd spend the rest of my life loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story, how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole to make you high, whispers that same old lie. Keep all your pain inside, 'cause no one will understand. The last thing this lost world needs is someone I'm trying to be. The truth that stay broken man, loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story, how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole all the ones I love,
Let's pray together. Lord, we recognize this morning that we are a people with scars, a living testimony proof that you're able to do more with our little than we could ever do with our lot. And Lord, we come to be challenged, we come to be molded, we come to be shaped by your word. And Lord, we do pray that because of the scars of life and the healing that only you can bring, that we can truly walk from this place today declaring, showing, living, that we're loving you, Jesus, in the midst of it all. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. This morning, I want to encourage you to open your Bibles to two specific places in the New Testament. The book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And the book of Acts chapter 5. Now, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we're just going to look at a small phrase or sentence, but we're going to use Acts chapter 5 as the illustration of this statement that is made in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. As you're looking for those two passages, if you're a guest or a visitor with us today, or for whatever reason haven't been with us in some while, we are walking together as a family of faith in a place where very few Baptists dare to trod. It is the study of the person and the work of the Holy Spirit. And over the last few weeks, we've studied who the Holy Spirit is and how he desires to move in our life. We've spoken about spiritual gifts and the fact that he wants to empower us to be more than we could ever be in our own strength and authority and power. Last week, we talked about being filled with the Holy Spirit. What does it look like when we're yielded to the Holy Spirit, when he increases and we decrease? For a lack of better terms, the last 3 weeks have been incredibly positive of how the Lord desires to move and work in our lives. But today we come to a challenge. Today we come to a warning sign. Today we come to the other side of the coin. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, toward the end of this first book from the letter and from the hand of the Apostle Paul, we have an admonition, we have a warning regarding the role and the person of the Holy Spirit in our lives. For those of you who may not be familiar, 1 Thessalonians is the first letter the Apostle Paul gave us. The church was in its infancy. We as believers 2,000 years ago were just learning, what did it really mean to turn from our idols unto the living God? What does it mean to be sanctified? What does it mean to be justified? What does it mean that one day Jesus Christ is going to return? This small book of the Bible encompasses all the basics of the faith for those not only in those days, but today who are in the beginnings of their faith. When you get to chapter 5, toward the end of 1 Thessalonians, there's all these statements of how we should live our life. And I want you to notice what verse 19 says. Quench not the Spirit. In other words, we are encouraged, we're admonished, we are warned as believers in Jesus Christ, whose bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost, that there can come a moment, there can come a time, there can come a place in our life where the Holy Spirit is actually quench. Now, before we get to all the details of the message today, allow me to preface the message by believing and stating that I concur that in Scripture, I believe over and over and over again, it declares that we are secure in our relationship with Jesus Christ. When we talk about quenching the Spirit, we're not talking about losing the Spirit, okay? What we're talking about is losing the momentum and the power and the movement of God on our life. We're not talking about going and being seated from the heavenlies and going to be seated in the opposite. No. What we're speaking of today is those who are believers in Jesus Christ, who have been yielded to and filled with the Holy Spirit, allowing, as 1 Thessalonians 5 says, to have the Spirit quenched in our lives. Now, let's define that for a moment. What does that mean? Well, it's very particular. And I know you can look up the word quench, and most of you have an idea of what that means, to take that and to put it out. But in your New Testament, the phrase or the word quench is used 8 times. And every single time it is used, it is in reference to or related to what we know as fire. Now, on one side of the spectrum, we have Mark chapter 9, where Jesus Christ is dealing with his adversaries. He's dealing with those that are struggling with his claim as Messiah. They don't want to believe in him. And he's sharing with them, these are the consequences. These are the eternal results of rejecting me. And in Mark chapter 9, he describes a place the Bible calls hell. Now, for those of you that struggle with this fact, please note this. Jesus talked about hell twice as much as he did heaven. And in describing it in Mark chapter 9, here's how he described hell. He said, it is a place where the fire is not quenched. In other words, never goes away. On the other side of the spectrum, we have Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, we as believers in Jesus Christ, we are encouraged, we are admonished to put on the whole armor of God. The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, and the shield of faith. You remember the description of the shield of the faith is that which in our lives allows for the fiery darts of the enemy to be quenched. In other words, what you see all throughout your New Testament is you see this analogy, this illustration of quenching is in regards to fire being put out. I don't find it accidental. In fact, I find it much the opposite, that when Jesus called the apostles together in Acts chapter 1, preparing them for his ascension, telling them to wait in Jerusalem till the Holy Spirit came upon them, he said, don't worry, you'll know. When the Holy Spirit descended in Acts chapter 2, do you remember the imagery? As cloven tongues of fire. In other words, the item, the illustration that the Lord himself used for being filled with the Holy Spirit is the same illustration. He said, do not quench the Spirit. So when we talk about quenching the Spirit, it means to take that which is alive, to take that which is on fire, to take that which is moving in the right direction, and for lack of better terms, to put on the brakes. Allow me to give you a picture. And by the way, most of the great pictures in regards to this subject matter come from the world of competition or the world of sports. But I think we all understand what it means to have something headed in the right direction and all of a sudden it cease. In fact, there's a word that I love to use in my vernacular. And my family teases me about this word. They think I'm obsessed with this word, but I think it's a good one. The word is momentum. Now, momentum, as I define it, is a series of consecutive victories. That can happen in the business world. That can happen in the sports world. That can happen in anything in life. When you begin to see things to line up the right way, you just build momentum. Everything starts heading the right direction. The great financial guy by the name of Dave Ramsey has a great statement when it comes to momentum. He says, when you have momentum, you look smarter than you really are. And when you don't, you look dumber than you really are. And what he is saying is when things are headed the right direction and they begin to compound, they begin to build on themselves, everything looks great. That is the best picture of the Spirit moving in our lives that I can gather today. And when we quench the Spirit, what is happening is we're taking that which is headed the right direction and halting its movement. Now, the sport that is claimed to be the most populated sport as far as the stands is concerned in our country is probably the best illustration of this. Now, I know what some of you are thinking, well, that's college football. No, it's actually NASCAR. NASCAR is the sport that claims to put more people in the seats than any other sport. But it is a sport of momentum. Do you know that those cars that can go 200 miles an hour, they don't get that fast in the first 60 feet. In fact, oftentimes it takes them many laps to build up to the full 200 miles an hour. And they'll be in the track and they'll be leading the race, so they'll be in the top three. And if you've never watched a race, it's a fascinating illustration. If they decide to get out of the groove, everything changes. You say, get out of the groove. What does that mean? Every single racetrack, no matter which one it is, has a line that is the best line to drive. And occasionally you'll have a driver decide, I'm going to take a risk. I'm going to get out of the groove. I'm going to go on the high side. I'm going to go on the low side. And what happens is when they get out of the line and they get out of the groove and they experience what oftentimes is called dirty air, they can go from first place to 20th place just like that. Why? Because they lose the momentum that they had. You understand that when we talk about quenching the Spirit, the illustration, the picture we have is that the Lord is moving and operating in our lives and we're headed the right direction until all of a sudden the decision is made to quench the Spirit. Now, momentum can head in a positive way. It can head in a negative. one of my wife and I's favorite movies, and I wish the language was better in it, but it's just not. It's a movie entitled The Replacements. If you're not familiar with the movie, it is the story of a bunch of football players who decide to go on strike in the NFL. And obviously, per the name, the replacement players come in. And over the course of time, they have to win 4 games to go to the playoffs. They lose the first game very dramatically, and the coach brings this team of replacements in, and he's going to give them a pep talk. He's going to give them an encouragement. He's going to help them out with what's happening in life. And the question that he asks the players, and it's a humorous scene in the movie, he asks them, "What are you fearful of? What are you scared of?" Typical, one of the players raises his hand and says, "Coach, I'm scared of spiders," you know? And he's like, no, that's not what I'm talking about. He said, "What are you really fearful of?" And he points to the used-to-be All-American quarterback of a major university who never made it in the pros. He says, "Shane," the name of the quarterback, "what do you think?" He says, "Coach, quicksand." Of course, all the players are like, "Oh, yeah, quicksand, that's some scary stuff." He said, no. "Explain." And the quarterback explains it this way. He says, "Have you ever been in a situation where everything's going fine, and then you make a mistake, and then you make a second mistake, and a third, and they begin to compound, and pretty soon it's like quicksand. You can't get out of the situation." When we talk about quenching the Spirit, the picture I want you to see when it says, "Do not quench the Spirit," is everything is going the way the Lord would have it to go, and all of a sudden, we can allow situations and circumstances and decisions in our life that can reverse course in a very expeditious manner. Now, I want you to go back to Acts chapter 5, and I want us to see how quenching the Spirit plays out in our lives. I think each and every one of us would agree, as a believer in Jesus Christ, and I know I'm not the only one in the room, we've all seen at points and times in our life where the Spirit has been quenched. We've been walking with the Lord, doing things, everything's great, and all of a sudden a decision is made or something happens, it's like, whoop, the brakes just got slammed on. We've all experienced that. But I want us to look at Acts chapter 5 and see what happens when, as individuals, we decide to quench the Spirit of God. How does that affect the whole? How does that affect the whole body of Christ? How does that affect the church of Jesus Christ? And can we just agree, as we turn to Acts chapter 5, that the church of Jesus Christ was experiencing some incredible momentum up to this point? I mean, after all, in Acts chapter 1, there's 120 of them. They're huddled in the upper room. They're fearful for their lives. They don't know how long till the Holy Spirit comes. The Holy Spirit comes in chapter 2. 3,000 people get saved. They get thrown in jail. They miraculously come out of jail. They stand up to persecution. Chapter 4, 5,000 people are added to the church. The ball is rolling in the right direction. Things are headed in the right direction. The Lord is filling them with His Spirit, and the body of Christ is expanding. Until chapter 5, there are two individuals, a couple, who arrive on the scene, and what we'll notice is in their lives, they have quenched the Spirit of God. It says, "But a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira his wife, they sold a possession. They kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it. They brought a certain part, they laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? While it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not your own power? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied unto men, but unto God." And Ananias, hearing these words, he fell down. He gave up the ghost. Great fear came on all them that heard these things. The young men arose, wound him up, carried him out, and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. Peter answered unto her. He said, "Tell me whether you sold the land for so much." And she said, "Yes, for so much." Then Peter said unto her, "How is it that you've agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out." Then fell she down straightway at his feet, yielded up the ghost. The young men came in, found her dead, carried her forth, buried her by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard those things. I want you to notice that last verse. And great fear came on the church who heard and saw those things. What you have here is an individual. You have a couple, Ananias and Sapphira, who we can definitively say has quenched the Spirit of God in their life. You say, well, how do you know that for a fact? Well, they were actually bringing goods to the apostles. They were doing much like it happened in chapter 4. There is evidence that they were believers, but they wanted to do it their way. They were willing to lie. They were willing to conspire. They were willing to say, we want to get out of the groove. And what do you see happen in this passage? You see discipline take place. What you see in Acts chapter 5 is when an individual, when a couple, when a group of people, when they decide to quench the Spirit of God, that God can and does at times prune those who quench the Spirit. Now, when we talk about pruning, obviously that is an agricultural term, and we're familiar with it. And what it means is to take that which is not operating properly, to take that which is wilted, and to remove it so that the plant, the tree, the bush, whatever it may be, as a whole, can grow healthier. Now, I know we understand this in our culture because many of us practice what is called crepe myrtle. You know what I'm talking about there, where you take a crepe myrtle and you just hack it, right? That's how I know it's time to do that, because there's just sticks all around town. That's all you see. But think about what that pruning practice is. If you were to allow the tree just to go, it would never reach its full potential. It would never become all it could be. It will stay only as it is. Can you imagine the church of Jesus Christ, 3,000 in chapter 2, 5,000 in chapter 4, beginning to expand, experiencing momentum? What would have happened if Ananias and Sapphira and their quenching of the Spirit would have been allowed to permeate and propagate within the body? Now, I know at this point there are those who say, well, I just don't get it. You always talk about we serve a God of second chances, a God of third chances, a God of fourth chances. Why is it that it looks like Ananias and Sapphira are one and done? Well, I don't believe that they're one and done. And in fact, my illustration goes back to the book of Genesis, an individual by the name of Cain. You know the story of Cain and Abel, most famously because Cain slew or killed his brother Abel. But the story begins with Cain and Abel, the two brothers, offering a sacrifice to the Lord. Abel's was satisfactory to the Lord, Cain's was not. Shortly thereafter, the Lord and Cain have a conversation. And the Lord says, hey, do you not understand this was not proper? If you don't get it right, sin lies at the door. What did Cain do? Did he bring a proper sacrifice? No. He responded much the opposite and killed his brother. What you see in Cain's life, I believe, you see in Ananias and Sapphira's life, and you see in every believer's life who quenches the Spirit. It always begins with a desire to do it your way, a desire to have it your way, a desire to get out of the groove of what God is doing for your sake and for yourself alone. And that desire experiences deception. You get deceived. You get deceived into thinking this is actually a good idea. You get deceived in believing that this is way, the way that things should be. This is a good idea. And then disobedience takes place. You actually take part in, participate in, or act out that which you desired and were deceived by. And once you disobey, guess what happens next? Death. And see, when you look back in the story of Cain, there was an opportunity. The Lord came to him and said, hey, buddy, you're headed down the wrong path. You can get this right if you desire to. Many people have looked at Ananias and Sapphira and said, why were they just one and done? Why didn't they get another chance? I want you to notice something in this passage, beginning in verse 3. Peter asked him four different questions. He even asked his wife a question about the matter, and at no point did they say, you know what, we headed down the wrong path. In other words, four times questions were asked of them. There is an interview taking place, and never once does Ananias interject and say, I did the wrong thing, I should have never done it, I'm sorry. In other words, God is a God of second chances and third chances and fourth chances and such. But disobedience always leads to death. And so what does God do? God allows their body. God allows their group to be pruned. It was for the sake of greater growth than the status quo. Now, the illustration I'm about to give to you took place several years in my life, and I'm going to go ahead and state this in advance. There are going to be some of you that don't like this story, and that's okay, but it's an absolute true story. We're in another state serving in another congregation, and the Lord was just moving, and things were working, but I know, and trust me, I'm not talking about this service. No, I'm kidding. But you know, there's just some of those folks in church that they just will not be moved. You know what I'm saying? Hey, let me use Southern terminology. They sticks in the mud. Y'all know who I'm talking about? They're going to do it their way, and they don't care what everybody else wants. They want their way. You know what I'm talking about? Well, just like any other place, we had a few of those folks, and man, they were just resistant. They did not want to go forward. They did not want to move. They didn't want to grow. They just wanted it their way. After church one day, one of the men in the church came up, put his arm around me. I don't know if you've ever had one of these conversations where the arm's around you, you're both looking forward, you're not looking at each other, but you're having a conversation. He puts his arm around me. He says, "Pastor, don't worry. We're about 5 or 6 good funerals from having revival around here." Ooh, that's strong, isn't it? What he was stating is, those that have quenched the spirits, unless they change or unless they're gone, don't expect the tree to be all that God desires it to be. Why does God prune? Why does he do it? Well, what we see is he's preventing stagnation. He's preventing regression. If you don't prune in the agricultural world, it'll never become what it could possibly be. You know, two stories, one from the Old Testament, one from the New Testament, that illustrate the prevention of God's pruning, his discipline on our lives. The story of Joshua chapter 7. The Israelites are winning battle after battle. They're doing great. I mean, every time they turn around, they're winning the battles. They win this great battle, and there's all kinds of gold and silver and what we call the spoils. And God makes it very clear, put it all in the treasury. No one will take it to their own home. As the story continues, all of a sudden the Israelites can't win a battle. They can't catch a break. There's death everywhere. Joshua calls out and says, "God, what's wrong?" He says, "There's sin in the camp. Somebody has taken the money. Somebody has taken the spoil." They put the feelers out. You know what they discover? A man by the name of Achan had disobeyed God. He had fallen into the deception that he deserved what he wanted. He took the gold, the silver, he put it in his tent. And when he was removed from the fellowship, guess what happened? They began to win the battles again. See, when we quench the Spirit of God in our lives, when we personally have rebellion in our lives, it does not just affect us, it affects all of us. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, there is a man at the church of Corinth, which by the way is a carnal church. His behavior is so bad, the Apostle Paul says it's worse than even what the Gentiles think about doing. His behavior with whom he is doing what he is doing is so horrendous that the Apostle Paul says he is not remorseful, he is not regretful, he is not repentful, so he needs to be removed, lest he infect the rest of the body. Now let me remind us of that story, that when the Apostle Paul takes this individual and they were removed from the fellowship, that the door is left open for when repentance takes place. But lest the whole body be infected, the disease must be removed. And so when you see these stories, these illustrations, we see how important it is to not allow the Spirit of God to be quenched in our lives. There is story after story in Scripture that when we quench the Spirit of God, the Lord has the right to prune us. He has the right to prevent the spoiling of the whole as the consequence of our own personal rebellion. So what does he desire? What does he truly desire in our lives? If we find ourselves in this position, if we find ourselves having quenched the Holy Spirit, what does he desire? Well, it's really precise. He desires you to admit it and confess it and deal with it. That's why 1 John 1:9 makes this very clear statement. It says, if we confess our sins, he, Jesus, is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. He can, he will, he desires to take that flame which has been quenched and to reignite it. He desires to take that momentum which has been ceased and restart it. But we've got to admit, we've got to confess, we've got to be clear, this is where we are. But let me share with you, it has a problem. In fact, back in Acts chapter 5, verse 2, it says that Ananias kept back a part of the price, his wife also being privy to it. Verse 9, together, why have you tempted the Spirit of the Lord? Let me give each and every one of us a warning when it comes to quenching the Spirit of God in our lives. We always want to justify ourselves. We always want to rationalize our behavior. And you know how we most often do so? We gravitate toward people in the same position we are. We gravitate toward others in rebellion. We gravitate toward others who are not living right. And we think if we can just have a party without any fire, we should be what we are. And what we don't discover is that we all end up in the same place and the same consequences. Both of them ended up in the grave because both of them decided to desire and to disobey against the things of God. Now hear me clearly. I believe we serve a God of second chances. I believe we serve a God of third, fourth, fifth, and infinite chances. But I want to close today with what I call gutter theology. The Lord Jesus Christ is capable, he is able, and he is willing to pull you out of whatever gutter you find yourself in today. In fact, Isaiah chapter 59 verse 1 says, "Is the Lord's hand shortened that he cannot save and he cannot deliver?" No. There is nothing you've done, nowhere you've gone, no place you've been that he cannot deliver you and rescue you from the gutter of life. But can I encourage you today? You don't have to go to the gutter. You don't have to fall into that trap. You don't have to fall into that lifestyle. You don't have to fall into that deception and lie. If we will not quench the Spirit, then we will continue to operate in the momentum and in the power and in the filling of the Holy Spirit. Folks, we don't have to fall into the gutter. Will he pick us up? Of course he will. He's a good, gracious God. But the Bible made it clear, do not quench the Spirit. Don't make decisions. Don't go places. Don't advocate things that will halt the momentum and the movement of the Holy Spirit in our lives. In Acts chapters 1 through 4, we see the Lord moving in a mighty way. Ananias and Sapphira show up on the scene. They are pruned. And do you know what you see through the rest of the book of Acts? The momentum continues to go. The Lord is going to move. He is going to operate. He is going to fill those whom are willing to not quench the Spirit in their lives. Let's pray with our heads bowed, our eyes closed. You know, we talk about being filled with the Holy Spirit, not quenching the Spirit. But maybe today you'd be that person, whether here in person or the other side of the cameras, to say, you know what, I don't even have the Holy Spirit. This is a foreign concept to me. As I shared earlier, the Holy Spirit is that which resides within us when we come to an understanding and a belief in Jesus Christ as our Savior. And maybe you're that person today saying, you know, that's what I need more than anything else. That's my desperate need. I got great news for you. You don't have to sign up for a bunch of classes. You don't have to check off a bunch of boxes. The Bible says whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Maybe you're that person today. Let me just encourage you to have a conversation with the Lord. You don't have to have this conversation out loud. In fact, you don't even have to use the same words that I might say, but maybe your conversation with the Lord would go a little something like this. God, today I just want to admit what you already know about me. I'm the problem. I've messed up and I've sinned. And I believe today that the only answer to my sin problem is Jesus Christ. I believe that Jesus Christ loved me so much that he was willing to be born on my behalf. I believe that Jesus Christ loved me so much he was willing to live a sinless life on my behalf. I believe that Jesus Christ loved me so much he was willing to pay the price for my sin on the cross. And 3 days later, he rose from the grave so I could be forgiven and I could be saved. God, today I don't have all the answers to the world's problems, but I do know that Jesus Christ is the answer to my sin problem. And the best way I know how, I'm asking you to forgive me, I'm asking you to save me, I'm asking you to change me from the inside out. With our heads still bowed, our eyes still closed, maybe you're that person today. In just a moment, I'm gonna pray over us, then we're gonna stand and sing. Let me encourage you just to step out and step forward. We, as a body of faith, we wanna celebrate today what God has and is doing in your life. But maybe you're that person who had that conversation years ago, maybe even decades ago, and today, if you were to be honest with yourself, the flame of revival, the flame of the Spirit of God moving in your life is a distant memory. It's been years, it's been decades, because the Spirit has been quenched in your life. Maybe today's the day of not walking down an aisle, but walking out of this place, recommitted, rededicated to allowing the Spirit of God to move and operate in the primary place in your life rather than yourself. Lord, as we come to this time of decision, we do celebrate that you're a God of second chances. We do celebrate that, Lord, oftentimes we lose track of how many opportunities that you have given us. But God, today is the day of this day and this opportunity, and you have spoken to us in this moment. May we not take it for granted. Oh God, whatever you've spoken in our lives, whatever you've communicated to us through your word, may we simply respond accordingly. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with me as Brian leads us. Whatever decision, I'll be here at the front.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him. Jesus shed his precious blood, blessings to bestow. Plunge now into crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust him, only trust him. Jesus is the truth, the way, and lead you into rest. Believe in him without delay, and you are fully blessed. Only trust him.
Church family, if you'll be seated for just a moment. I know it is summertime and there are people traveling to and fro, but it's been a blessed day. The guest reception has been full. There have been people joining the church, and we're about to celebrate that in just a moment. Alan Jones is back from the mission field. He's been in Central America leading dozens and dozens of our folks in mission activity down there. He's going to close our service. I'm going to make my way to the guest reception, but one thing I want you to be aware of, tonight at 6 o'clock right here, our evening service, we're going to be addressing a subject matter. What can we, as a believer in Jesus Christ lose? So back here tonight at 6 o'clock. Alan Jones, I'm going to turn it over, brother. It's all yours.
Well, amen. It is great to be back and great to be a part of an exciting church. I tell you, vacation time is here, folks, and we've had 13 additions today. Amen? It's so exciting. Let me introduce some of these folks to you. This is the Colquitt family. Y'all coming up. They've been coming for a while, and they're coming by statement of faith, and we're so excited to have you. Tell us names. Lee.
I'm Lee.
And Jillian.
Molly.
Chloe.
And Aaron.
And Aaron. We are so glad to have you guys. If you'll welcome them, would you let it be known by saying amen? And we'll be praying for you and just welcome you into our family. And also, we have Blake and Megan Smalley. Y'all come and join us here. They've been coming for a long time, and they say, we're joining. So they're also coming by statement. If you'll welcome them, let it be known by saying amen. Great, great. So good to have y'all. with us, and we want you to come by and meet them. And if you are visiting with us today and you have not met our pastor, we have some hospitality folks over here that would love to take you right after this service into our welcome center and meet our pastor. He will have a gift for you, and he'd love to get to know you personally. It has been a great summer already. We literally have people all over the world. Had a young lady that's been in Asia for a year that was sharing with one of our Sunday school classes. We've had teams come back from Uganda and Costa Rica, teams going to Honduras. So please keep our folks in your prayers as we continue through the summer of taking the gospel beyond these doors. Church, you do a great job of that. And it's a blessing to be a part of that. So let's all stand and we'll close in prayer. 4th of July is coming up. Enjoy those fireworks. The Wednesday night of the 4th of July, I don't know if that's the 3rd or the 4th, we will not have anything going on here. But both Sundays, next Sunday and the following Sunday, we will have regular schedules. So Sunday school and services will be regular since the 4th falls in the middle of the week. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for this church family. Lord, I thank you for Jeff and the way he brought the word, the way he brings the word, Lord. And I thank you that your word is alive. Lord, I know you've spoken to hearts this morning, and I just pray, Lord, that we won't quench the Spirit. But Lord, we will take what you've given us and we will proceed, Lord. We will be obedient, Lord, that others can see that you're alive in our lives and in our church, Lord. Thank you for these families that have joined us. Lord, I pray that they will minister to us. We will minister to them as we become the family you've called us to be. Lord, help us to glorify you this week. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.